Okay, ladies and gentlemen, welcome to another episode of Balls in Your Face Marketing. For today's episode, I highly suggest that you find yourself a nice, quiet space with very few distractions. Perhaps pour yourself a glass of wine or brandy, you choose your poison, but shit's about to get deep. Because today, I have with me, not one, but two PhD doctors of philosophy. These are the founders of the Petrarch group. I have Dr. Alexander Rosenthal. He's also a lecturer at Johns Hopkins, and Dr. Miles Smit. Gentlemen, thank you so much for coming on the show.
Well, thank you. That probably sounded more impressive than I may be able to reach, but I much appreciate it.
Oh, I think there's all kinds of stuff there that I didn't even get into, for example, and we can certainly get into this at one point. Alexander, I know that you have a book coming out, so I don't think there's any oversell in that at all. But before we get into stuff, why don't we talk a bit about the Petrarch Group and what it is and what its mandate is?
Yeah, so I mean, basically, Petrarch, if you've ever heard the name, is the figure who is often credited with sort of starting the Renaissance and Renaissance humanism and the whole idea of going back to the classics, right? Meaning the culture and literature of ancient Greece and Rome. And it really sort of set an educational curriculum for the Western world that lasted, we could say, well into the 20th century and still is not entirely gone today. And so my inspiration or thought was there's in the modern age of technology, there's no reason why a lot of these principles and thoughts that began in the Renaissance or resurge in the Renaissance, why we could not reach a broader audience using contemporary online technologies, right? A broader audience than one could reach by conventional teaching and writing. And I had also found in my experience that I met a lot of people who are interested in the liberal arts in one form or another, but decided to take other routes in their lives and never got back to it. And so my thinking was that one way in the contemporary world in which we could reach people like that who find this sort of philosophy and history and literature and so forth very interesting is to do it in an online way where people can organize their time as they choose. So does that sort of
that absolutely helps and answer the question. And I think it also actually helps segue a bit into why it is that here I am with a show that is dedicated to marketing and sales advice for people, and why am I sitting here with two philosophers? And I'll give a bit of the backstory towards this is that really, first of all, when I started the show, I noticed, you know, even though that was the mandate of this show, was to just talk about marketing and sales advice, a lot of guests, in fact, wanted to speak about other subjects, contemporary, issues related to society, how social media and other technologies have affected the world, the future, mindset, all kinds of these other themes. And that I also found myself that I wanted to speak about, I had things to say about these issues. And what I think realized is that, in fact, it makes sense that you know, as much as perhaps technology and social media has transformed my industry of marketing, it has, in fact, transformed the world. Mm-hmm. And I think, and so, for sure, you know, there, these things are also sort of somewhat interrelated now. And this is what kind of inspired this particular meeting, was that at one point, in fact, I wrote that article, Goodbye Kardashian, Hello Epictetus, where I suggested that we were living in an age of narcissism, that there has been a bit of fatigue that has grown of that. I think we're a little sick of, or at least some segment of the population is sick and tired of the Kim Kardashians, these sort of celebrity for the sake of celebrity itself with no real talent. And that I have witnessed a bit of a movement of meaning, a desire for people to sort of reconsider, well, what, you know, challenge conventional wisdom, challenge the old ways of education and how we think about things and how we live our lives and create our careers, and a desire to live more meaningful, fulfilling lives. I'm almost reluctant to use the word balance because work-life balance, I find, is a bit of a, I find it kind of, the implication of that you have to sort of take from one to give to the other. And I think that's a lot what this movement I see challenging, is saying, well, can we not sort of fit work, life, and play all into this one box? So I see this movement happening, and I think this is where it's very interesting to speak to the two of you, because in that article, for sure, I was advocating for, again, a return to some of that, some of that classical education that perhaps is missing in a lot of people's education. So what are your thoughts about where we are today and why that this subject, these older subjects are still relevant today?
Yeah, well, sort of the core of the question. I think you're absolutely right. I mean, there's so much talk in, you know, these days about sort of the crassness and the vulgarization of society and the concerns about that. But of course, the technology and media are just a tool, right? I mean, it is what we want to make it. There is no inherent reason why it can't be used for more, let's say, elevated types of activities. Now, what is it about the classics? So one thing that I found in my studies about the classics, so we're basically talking about a tradition that begins in ancient Greece, but it basically was the core of the Western educational system until the 20th century, right? I mean, if you look back even 19th, early 20th century, what were people studying in secondary school and in universities? It was largely a curriculum built around the classics. And so the first thing is, why is that? What I began to notice is that the periods of time, you know, whether you're looking at the Renaissance or whether you're looking at even like the rise of modern physics in the 19th and 20th century, all of these people had this foundation in classical education, you know, whether it's in the sciences, like people like Heisenberg and Max Planck, or whether you're looking at Shakespeare and Cervantes, or whether you're looking at the great artists like Michelangelo. So there's been this perennial link between the classics and human excellence, right? And my thinking was, as the educational system has been moving away from the classics, that there's still a demand, I think, for that type of cultivation. And how do we make it available in the contemporary world? So those were kind of, so I think the very concept of the classics involves the idea that we're talking about things which have timeless value, that speak to human beings in every age, right? They're never... when we talk about issues like happiness and virtue and what is courage and all these sorts of things, they never get old. They're evergreen, right? With talking about things that have timeless value, that are have been considered to be works of surpassing excellence, and that are also foundational. So does that yeah. help?
Well, okay. So let me two little things that I want to sort of extract from that. I guess one was, okay, so is the technology just the tool, or is the medium the message?
Well, I mean, in my opinion, it is a way that, for example, you can reach all kinds of people who would never think about getting involved in the classics. You know, in the old days, if you were in, say, Victorian England, you pretty much had to get into a good private school and then go to Oxford and Cambridge if you really wanted to, you know, immerse yourself in this kind of literature. And it wasn't really as widely available. And in the contemporary age, you could be anywhere doing just about anything. Mm-hmm. and potentially you can be reached by, so there's more accessibility. So I don't think perhaps you lose, you know, I've had experience with both on-site and online teaching. There are, I'm not going to say that there's no losses at all. There's, it's more impersonal. But at the same time, there's vastly more flexibility. You know, people can learn on their own, at their own pace and schedule. And time, you know, the time and place becomes, is in some ways surpassed.
Yeah, and you can also, like, you can have a lecture in a class that, that, you know, for, there is no limit to how many students can take on a lecture in comparison to how many people you could fit into a classroom.
Exactly. There's another thing that I've noticed, which is, for example, when you teach on site, what you'll generally notice is that there'll be like the three or four most extroverted students in a large class who tend to dominate class discussions, right? Not everybody is as forward about, you know, stating their opinions in front of a group of people. But when you say post a question, and you give them a certain amount of time to respond to a question about the readings, people become more thoughtful, and the shyness factor tends to dissipate. So that's another little advantage, I think, of the online format.
Okay. Tell me, you know, and maybe Miles, you and I have had a few conversations a little bit about this, about, you know, how, you know, is our current education system sufficient in for the modern age, or is it in need of a major upgrade?
Well, I think it's changing. So I think changes are needed, and they're driven both by issues on the supply side and some changes that you hinted to on the demand side. And we've experienced that. I think there's some discontinuity, meaning that it's sometimes going to be newer institutions that meet the newest needs, and then some of the legacy prestige institutions catch up. So if you talk about the online university, which is really what we're talking about here, and it was part of the starting concept that Alex approached me with, we had this idea of a kind of a Noah's Ark for Western civilization. And a part of that is just the fact that there's interest in it from people around the world. And part of it is just an opportunity in neglected treasure. So a lot of brick and mortar universities, which up till the 20th century and into the 20th century, as Alex was alluding, was making higher education available to more and more people, began simply to pay less attention or even to drop outright some of the classical curriculum items we're talking about. And so that means we're not only talking about reaching new people, but making remedial alternatives available to people who are dedicated to full-time, classically oriented post-secondary studies. One of the largest pockets of students that we came across was a group of about 40 Greek students coming to us as English language educators because their university in Greece was basically diminishing or decimating its classics department. So, you know, some of it is an issue of exploiting new channels. And I think your question was, you know, does the channel make a difference? Does the medium affect the message, or does it constitute the message? Certainly, I think one thing you're talking about is a more restless form of attention and communication than the classical ideal that Alex was referring to. We have a deluge of information. And the problem is, you know, when you have an overabundance of information, what in that information is real insight? And out of insight, how do you get wisdom, and how do you map wisdom onto your life? So that's part of the search. But at the very least, the channels make it possible for people to connect who would have been cut off. So if you were a Greek student 30 years ago and your university dropped the classics department you wanted to use, you had to either travel or become an autodidact. And that's a bit of a scattershot answer, but I think all of these things are in play between the new and the old. And part of what's so interesting is some of the technologies we're talking about are very new. We're still trying to figure out what they mean for human interaction. Do they alter human behavior and thinking? Some of the ideas we're talking about are really, really old, meaning they were, you know, they're biblical in nature, or they come from the ancient Mediterranean world and some of the other civilizations of the Axial Age, as Alex and I have discussed elsewhere. But at the same time, there's some surprisingly recent changes And the response to those changes, like the dropping of Latin, which used to be a kind of formative component for scientists as well as humanists, are still touching our educational system. And maybe, just to answer your original question, we're just now coming to a point where we realize some of the loss or the damage that comes with those, that curricular neglect. And that's the opportunity for people like Petrarch Institute, but many others in this space, to kind of create a click and order university to make up for what some of the brick and mortar universities have been overlooking.
Yeah. That was kind of an interesting point you made about science and technology. I was reading how in the late 19th century, when they were first thinking of dropping Greek and Latin requirements to enter university, so they were first thinking about it in the hard sciences, right? And a group of just hard scientists, you know, it's easy to figure out that philosophers and poets, right, would be interested in the classics, but we're talking about chemists and people like that. And the professors in Germany wrote to the German government, please don't get rid of the classical formation, right? Why? Because they found that those who went through technical schools did better in the first semester, but were very soon surpassed by those who went through classical education. And the speculation was that this was because of the sort of habits of mind and intellectual creativity that the classics tended to foster. And very interestingly, that generation of Germans was the one which produced Schrödinger and Max Planck and Werner Heisenberg and all the great physicists that really were foundational for the modern, the last great wave of the scientific revolution, we can call it. So that's kind of an interesting point. On the technology end, I mean, I think it's kind of an interesting macro-micro thing, right? So on the macro level, you could see why humanistic education would be hurt a bit, because if you're given a choice, if you ask many parents, would you rather your college-age son or daughter study computer science or Virgil's poetry? You can see why many would say go for the computer science, because technical skills obviously are highly valorized in a very technically oriented civilization. But at the same time, at the level of a business, at the level of marketing, at the level of reaching people, obviously the technology has huge advantages. So that's, yeah.
I had a neuroscientist on the show a little while back who was able to sort of speak to some of the technological impacts on how our brains work and how our minds work. And it was kind of shocking, actually. What she was saying is that, you know, the technology has, without a question, reduced our attention spans. And so what she said was that, you know, based on my age, that meant that I probably had the attention span of roughly, 7 to 8 seconds, that it is conceptualized that those in the Victorian age had about 12 seconds, and that a young millennial or Generation Z or so on are down to 3. I find it a little scary that, you know, our attention spans are, you know, that goldfish attention spans are increasingly like surpassing ours by, I mean, their memories still suck, but, that's a bit of a decline. And that was my question that she didn't have an answer to, was, you know, I said, is it good for our systems of education to be catering to sort of defaults of how our brains operate? And I use the example of Sesame Street because, you know, that was when, you know, in growing up, that was a fairly new show, and they recognized, oh, okay, children have short attention spans. So we will ensure that every segment here of the show lasts no longer than 30 seconds. Well, are you just, you know, compounding the problem, right? Or are you actually helping them? And I'm not so sure about that. The other thing that I found very, that I thought really fascinating, and I haven't really been able to confirm this, but I saw a video the other day of Seth Godin, and he was speaking about, you know, how he says, you know, I know where our current education system came from. The design of it was built by industrialists. Its purpose was to produce compliant factory workers who would show up, you know, to work and follow orders. And he used, what was fascinating to me, and I haven't been able to confirm this, perhaps you guys would know, is he speaks about the story of Icarus. And what he says is that they, in fact, that the industrialists changed the story, so that we all know the part of the story about Icarus flying too high. You know, that's dangerous. Apparently, what he was saying is that they in fact removed a section of the story that of the warning of flying too low. The industrialists were quite all right for people to fly too low, for their ambitions to be, to remain low. They just didn't want you to have an ambition that was too high and perhaps have wild, grand ideas of starting your own factory, right?
I mean, I have no inside knowledge on the internal psychology of industrialists. I mean, Miles might have more knowledge than I. But what I would say is this: there has always been a dualism between two kinds of education. One is what we call education, which is about learning the skills set that you need to perform a job, right? And that could be the skills you need to work in a factory, or it could be computers, or it could be whatever it is, right? But then there is the ideal that goes back to the Greeks, which is the ideal of humanist education, what the classes Werner Jaeger spoke about, the education of man into his true form, right? By which he meant the development of all of the full range of human powers, intellectual, moral, aesthetic, right? And it's not aiming at, you know, preparing you to be a specialist at a particular job. It's preparing to develop you as a human being. Mm-hmm. That's what I think we have lost a bit. It's one of the reasons why I'm interested in the Petrarch thing. Now, the thing is, as it turns out, as we've just mentioned, with all these achievers in science, in literature, in the visual arts, in politics, the American founding fathers were steeped in classical education. What we find is that the people who are most developed in this way are often the people who can, who when they apply themselves to business, to politics, to art, to science, are able to do so in the most capacious way. So I think even at the utility level, humanist education has a great value, but there's also a value just in the enrichment that it gives to a human being in their life, right? So,
yeah.
So I think there's multiple ways in which we can look at the value of this kind of education and the potential tragedy should it be lost.
Yeah, Miles, you look like you had some thoughts.
There are a lot of interesting themes coming out at once. Just to touch on a couple of them, I mean, I think it's interesting that one of the things that the classical tradition and the thinking and the mores of the classical thinkers teach us, perhaps surprisingly, is how broad the art of the possible is. I think in an age where technology spreads rapidly and in which people imitate each other or come to a kind of common way of living, whether it's, you know, staring at your phones or lining up for trains, all those things, we do sometimes succumb to a fatalistic perspective, which is that there's a mode of living, and as those modes of living change over 20 and 30 and 50 and 100 years, the way you live and what you prioritize and how you use your time must change with that. When in fact, there's always perhaps more diversity than we picture. So certainly, you know, in terms of the elite versus the masses, you know, in the origin of the classic perspective that Alice was talking about, in, you know, it's Athens more than any other Greek city, and it's a small group of citizens more than any Athenian, and it's a philosophically minded clique more than any of that subset that really drives what we're talking about. You know, your Socrates, your Aristotle, and so on. At the same time, these things came to be the making of an education that reached large numbers of people. If you look not just at, this is an example Alex mentioned a few days ago, entry requirements, not the curriculum, but the entry requirement for a student of the University of Virginia decades or centuries ago, they would basically be expected to be fluent in Greek and Latin and have read the canon before they even enter the halls. At the same time, I think a science fiction author brought this up recently, and actually republished it, the curriculum for high school students in San Francisco, the early 1900s, I can't remember whether it was 1906 or say 1916, but you get the idea, first quarter of the 20th century, the high school reading list would be very ambitious for an Ivy League undergraduate student today. And it's not as if the modern world began after that. So, you know, I guess it's keeping the sense of the awareness that these kind of things can reach into, can inform, and can actually help build the modern world just as much as they, the latter-day world, just as much as they help build and preserve the ancient world. And another thing is, I just go back to the point about diversity. I know what you mean about making students or graduates who are ready for, say, factory or large corporate employment. But there are interesting experiments that people might know about, might not know about in recent years on that front as well. There's a college on the border, I think, between Nevada and California, very, very small. They only admit something like 26 students a year. And it was founded, I think, by an engineer, an engineering entrepreneur. And the idea was, how do you get students who are not just technically competent, but morally fit to lead and work? And the idea is that this small college is governed by the students who are studying. So they're not expected only to study there and be looked after by the university in loco parentis. They're supposed to run the place themselves. They do horseback ranching. So, you know, you can combine at least some of the virtues of the technical ethos with the classical one. And I was actually going to ask the question, Jules, that you asked to me of yourself in a certain perspective. You know, you were musing about an age of narcissism and at the same time, you know, this huge comeback of Stoic authors. What do you think about the channels? I mean, Alex and I are struggling to learn about Patreon and super chats and, you know, monetizing video channels and stuff like that. You do marketing full time. What do you find about the life of serious ideas in these information saturated channels and, you know, and the world of marketing where, you know, I guess the packaging and the persuasion of an idea is as important as its content?
Okay, so I think the point that I was referring to earlier about people having sort of shorter attention spans, and also the point about the just the sheer volume of information out there, makes it very difficult for sure for people to sit down and fully absorb, you know, people spend a lot less time really reading a full book, watching even a full video. You know, there's this tendency for people to just sort of scan headlines and then react to them. Sometimes those headlines don't necessarily, in fact, correspond with the actual message of the article itself, and yet somebody's immediately triggered, and this causes a sort of shitstorm on the internet. You know, like, oh my gosh, I can't believe they said that, when in fact that wasn't even what they were saying. And then you get these sort of you know, straw man arguments breaking out that have nothing to do with what the article was about in the first place. What I have also observed at the same time is that as much as, you know, people maybe are really just sort of looking, you know, surveying the internet and content sort of like sharks, just kind of like, you know, picking out at various pieces of information. Once they latch onto something, once they find something that they find compelling, then in fact there is this huge desire and this hunger to delve into it and really then invest the time. So I actually think that the appetite is there for people to find something that is interesting to them, that they are willing to, and then they are willing to engage with it more seriously. And the perfect example, as controversial as he may be, is Dr. Jordan Peterson, who had all of his, you know, hundreds of minutes of his lectures on YouTube, and getting a certain number of views. It took one viral video for him to just simply explode on the internet. But as soon as people saw that, like, okay, well, what else does he have to say? And then once they found that there was this, you know, huge anthology of lectures and information and thoughts about religion and thoughts about other subject matter, they engaged with his content much more thoroughly, and people have been absorbing that content ever since en masse. So that tells me that there is the appetite out there for longer form content. And as a marketer, actually, without a doubt, I break the rules all the time. You know, people have said that, you know, your videos should only be, should be under 90 seconds. And in fact, if you can go, you know, down to 60, even better. If you can go down to 30, even better. And I break the rules. And part of that is because, well, you know, in this current market, and because of new technologies, the fact that you can actually target people, one of the current sort of phrases that people are talking about these days is find your tribe. And I've twisted that myself to say I think that should be find your village. And this somewhat sort of relates to what we're talking about, is that I think our education system needs to be changed in the sense that I think we're moving towards a gig economy, a freelance economy. I've seen predictions anywhere from 36% to 50% of the workforce is expected to be freelance by the year 2020. And also I've spoken a lot about this economy of authenticity, that people are now actually quite drawn to, you know, finding people that they are, that they seem to like, agree with, aligned with their personality, their values, their mission. And that you can target those people. You know, you could, 20 years ago, if you know, the example I use is if you sort of had wanted to start a business around some strange, funky socks that you crocheted by hand, and that only appealed to 1 in 1,000 people, you could not build a business around that because you would have to knock on a lot of doors, make a lot of cold calls. You didn't have a business model there. Whereas now that you have platforms like Facebook and you can use psychometric data to now target those audiences, you can say, ah, well, I happen to know that the people who like my socks also listen to this podcast, drink this beer, wear these jeans, et cetera, et cetera. And now I can target my advertising specifically to that audience and do that. So in the case that the reason why I break the rules is because I would like to curate a more thoughtful audience who aren't just going to survey just the headlines. The final observation that I would make is that I think, so different platforms cater to different tendencies, I guess, in this realm. So, for example, I think, you know, I often refer to Twitter as the bar fight, right? It is a platform that is catered to that short form, you know, only, you know, a little over 100 characters and then you're done. And it facilitates that mask of anonymity, right? You can create 20 different accounts, and therefore, you know, people are able to sort of hide behind that the masquerade effect, or like the Halloween effect. I always observe how the people on Halloween, once they get that mask on their face, they behave a little more well. Facebook, I would say, has perpetuated this age of narcissism that I complain about, right? It's all been about, look at me in front of this Lamborghini, look at me with my plate of lasagna. And it's very like, you know, look at me, and look at how wonderful my life is. LinkedIn seems to me to be where I have observed this shift. It has, especially with the introduction of video, people are now using it as a platform to engage, as a growth platform, to allow themselves to be vulnerable, allow themselves to be honest about the struggles that they're having or challenges in the workplace, what it's like to work with depression, for example. Not in a woe is me kind of way, in a, you know, here are tips and tricks that I've learned that have allowed me to cope. And it's been a very supportive platform for that purpose. So I took a lot of different sort of angles on that question, but I hopefully that answers what you're getting at, or what the answer that you're looking for.
Yeah, there's a couple of thoughts that I had about, I mean, you were talking earlier about attention span and how the new technologies have affected it. I'm wondering if there's so there's a lot in that I agree with if we look at particularly the early developments in technology, so in 20th century. So if you think about how people spent their leisure in the 19th century, it was through reading, right? Which engages the imagination and is quite active, right? Your mind is quite active when you're reading a book. Then it went to radio, and you imagine people in the FDR era, right, sitting around listening to fireside chats and dramas and stuff like that.
Little radio show.
Exactly. I mean, it's more passive, but it's there's still quite a bit of imagination, right? When you're hearing a gunfight in radio, your imagination's still active. And then television, to me, seems like the nadir, right? I mean, basically, it's almost completely passive. And I'm just wondering, on the more optimistic side, I'm wondering whether the increased interactivity, obviously you're going to have a lot, you know, since the internet is a microcosm of humanity, you're going to have a lot of garbage, right, obviously, but it's also a microcosm. I mean, there's a lot of more elevated things going on the internet as well, and you can sort of find your community. So that's one thought that I have on the more optimistic side, that it's a little more active, a little bit, there's a lot of information out there. If you want information, if you're that kind of person, there's a lot out there that you can absorb. You can interact with people from other cultures that you couldn't do so easily in other times. So that's one thing I'm thinking about. And I also just kind of have the fundamental optimism that what does it mean to be a classic? It means something which has survived all the trends and modes, right? So Shakespeare might be kicked out of the University of Pennsylvania's, the Portrait of Shakespeare was infamously kicked out of the University of Pennsylvania's English department at one point. But I'm not too worried that nobody will be reading Shakespeare in 300 years. You know, the whole idea of the classics is that there are these constant changes of fashion that go on, but there's also the things that still survive the test of time, as it were, right? The sorting that goes on, you know, people are still listening to Bach and Mozart centuries later, you know? So that was just another thought that I have, that there is, you know, we sometimes might be, just like the person who's looking at stocks might be looking at the day trading instead of the longer term trends. I think it's a good moment in time and history to be looking at some of the long term prospects that the new technologies and the new world that's coming into being may be creating, including for things like the classics and other forms of high culture. So.
Yeah. Well, no, and something that you had said earlier, Alex, I think is very key. That in fact, that when you brought up the example of the German schools and systems, and the fact that having been exposed to that classical education, in fact, did produce sort of better results, better physicists, etc. So. And yeah, like I'm an advocate. I'm also an optimist as well. That I mean, as much as I feel it important to be honest about the sort of the downsides of what we see on technology and the sort of trend towards narcissism that at least has existed. Like I said, I see a trend more towards this search for meaning. And when I talk about this sort of move towards a gig economy, freelance economy, I think that I consider it all a very positive shift. It's a shift away from, you know, that sort of golden age of the Walmarts and so on. We saw it. We see now the recent collapse of Toys R Us. And back to where the power is in the hands of the individual. And like I constantly say, like, I think, you know, the thing about, I really believe nowadays that the small business owner, the individual in a way, almost has the upper hand relative to the larger corporations for several reasons. One is that they can be much more nimble, much more agile. They can adapt with the technologies. You know, that's one of the challenges with a large corporation is that, you know, when you want to change the direction of that ship, it takes a long time to steer that ship over.
Yeah.
Whereas you as an individual can, you know, re-educate yourself, find new learnings, find new tools, adapt to shifts in the economy very, very quickly, more adeptly. And second,
and also, I mean, if you think about education, just think about what it would cost to build a brick and mortar school versus setting up an online type.
Absolutely. That's a thing. And same thing for your business. Exactly. When you, yeah. you don't, when you're not for, well, exactly. I mean, I think that's what has helped my business grow as it has, is that I've foregone a lot of the traditional trappings of advertising agencies, you know, namely, you know, exposed brick walls, ping pong tables, and retainer contracts. right? Yeah. So all of these things, you know, and by the way, also like full-time employees, which is an expense. Now I can kind of hire individuals from anywhere around the world. I can source a very talented person anywhere. I'm not restricted to a local market individual, nor am I restricted to paying them a salary all year round. On a per need basis, on a per project basis, I can bring somebody in and provide that service as needed and bring it into the fold. And so again, we were able to kind of help and assist each other in this business. And then thirdly, again, the reason why I think we're moving towards that, why that the individuals have this advantage all of a sudden, is because really just a fatigue with the perfectly curated, polished advertising model, and a sort of a shift and a change in brand loyalties. You know, younger generations are not loyal to the General Electric or whatever, as perhaps our grandparents would say, oh, well, that means quality, you know, for them. Yeah. They would be very loyal to it. Well, now everything kind of has a certain standard of quality.
Yeah.
And that younger generation will perceive, look at that corporation as having the sole mission of raising the value of its stock. Whereas, you know, they can watch an individual like myself and say, well, I like his passion. I like, you know, hear it. He can explain what his business is. They can watch a video of, you know, they are perhaps more likely to drink a microbrewery craft beer because they got to watch the brewmaster himself say, this is why I made it. And this is why I love to do it. And his mission is to make this beer.
I mean, that's a very interesting trend that we're seeing, I think, across quite a few fields, as sort of this rise of craftsmanship and this new interest in the handcrafted. You know, the machines are almost creating things that are too perfect in some sense for certain markets. I think Fareed Zakaria was talking about how, you know, people will want to buy suits that have that little imperfection that shows that it was handmade rather than, you know, turned out in a factory, and people are willing to pay a premium for it. So that's kind of, an interesting trend that's going on, right? Was everything sort of too perfect in some sense, too prepackaged, I think.
What's exciting, and this is why I think it is, a great, especially again, when you use that example to say that in fact those who were trained in that classical education model have thrived well, you know, it really becomes, you know, more of an individualistic experience of what are your personal, if that's the model, and we're going to have more people work operating in a freelance basis, well then, you know, how should one be managing their careers? And it's a very different model from the, okay, go to university, choose your major, go apply for a job, and then you work for that company forever and ever. That model, I think, is somewhat dead. It becomes more now a matter of, well, what are you as an individual personally passionate about? What is the things that you do that put you in a sort of state of flow? Because for whatever it is that you hate to do, you can find somebody else who loves to do it.
Yeah.
And so again, back to the sort of village economy mindset that, you know, we can all kind of operate. And again, as you're saying, like, maybe we'd like that suit that has that slight imperfection, because then it's, you know, we can find our village. So I find this this very fascinating. And I, in an optimistic way, I think it's a trend towards something that's very positive. So I think it's a great timing for an organization like yours, like Petrarch, that is making this available to people in a sort of a cost-effective way, and as you mentioned off the top, in a way that people can consume at their own pace, and is zero in on the areas. And philosophy is for sure one of those subjects that helps you with life and in various stages of your life. So I think its value today is perhaps. I see a resurgence for it for sure, and I need a desire for it. So I think the timing of it is outstanding.
Can I just ask you one question? So you mentioned that article you had written about Epictetus and the Kardashians out, Epictetus in. What do you think? I mean, what do you think is sort of driving that? And I guess if you could just tell me a little bit about what the article was. What was your basic point in the article?
Well, okay. So part of it, I think what's just driving that is fatigue. After a while there's only so many plates of pasta that you want to look at on the internet. Yeah. The other side of it, I think too, is I think maybe also just a fatigue with the sort of shallowness of it, the emptiness right. of it. I think also as well, part of it again is just an observation again of this trend that I've seen again of using LinkedIn as a growth platform and people really talking more about these subjects. One of the things that I've said in other articles is that I blame, as much as I'm an advocate, I think social media facilitates all kinds of great tools. It's a great marketing vehicle. It's a great way to grow a business. I feel it important to be honest about its downsides. And I blame social media and that superficial presentation of self in part for a rise in depression that we've seen in the West. Yeah. And I think the explanation behind that is that people see these sort of perfectly curated versions of everybody else's life presented online that isn't actually a reflection of their true lives, but it looks to the young individual as if everybody else is happy and their lives are wonderful and opulent. And why does that not match my personal life? And so as a result, it creates this sort of sense of an inadequacy that leads to depression.
I mean, as we know from the headlines about lots of figures in Hollywood and the media, even the people who have so quote unquote made it, you know, with money and fame and all and looks and everything that, you know, we're told that makes you happy in the world. We see that there's quite a bit of depression and drug abuse and all sorts of issues going on in that.
Absolutely.
World.
Absolutely. So I think as a result of that, you know, people are starting to question fun now after you. I think part of it is just sort of this just infancy of the new technology. And I think it almost, one of the things that I've sort of suggested is that the internet is somewhat of a manifestation of and social media and all these things is a manifestation of Carl Jung's the collective consciousness. Yeah. And it speeds up that dialogue in many regards. But because it was just all brand new, it was sort of like we almost had to reset. We kind of started at that infantile, oh my gosh, now we can immediately kind of have this conversation and share our lives in this instant way. And so we resorted to that initial sort of, you know, every child is born narcissistic, and you'll never get rid of narcissism in its entirety. But as I said, there's a certain maturing that took place. Yeah. And at first it was just kind of like, oh my gosh, look, I can share all this stuff and look, I can present myself in this way. And that had its appeal for a little while. But to put it sort of more crudely, you know, people have very decent bullshit detectors. And after a while, we've started to say, yeah, that this is a load of crap. And let's get real. Let's get honest. And I see that movement again as having started on LinkedIn. And I think that will continue to transcend into other platforms and future platforms.
I mean, certainly we saw that on LinkedIn when we started a chat group. It was interesting. I mean, I mentioned the large pool of Greek students we came across because their university, as it were, left them out in the cold. But some of the sort of more far-flung students we attracted, meaning people from, you know, well-advanced careers in applied fields like programming or whatnot, that, you know, from a place like Finland or something, they came to us through LinkedIn. And so one of the advantages was in terms of the issue of authenticity or integrity and character that you touched briefly, both of you did. I mean, on LinkedIn, you're supposed to present yourself as you are, right? You're not supposed to be anonymous. You're not supposed to be skater 8 from, you know, some unknown location. You're supposed to be who you are, and your brand is made up of things like your professionalism and your trustworthiness. And what's interesting is other than that, people don't have to be very closely connected to start collaborating and sharing ideas on a platform like that. So I think it's an interesting it's an interesting example of fundamental things re-emerging or reasserting themselves through experimentation, even though there's a lot of ferment And there's a certain amount of recency bias where people are attracted to the latest or the fastest or the most image-rich or the most capable media. As people really interact on a more than transactional way, like, you know, I'm using you for X now and then we're both gone into the ether. This idea of our lives in some ways becoming more and more integral over time, or at least that being the ideal, and that being the kind of accountability we have, even in kind of digital crowds of strangers, is a sort of vindication of the classical approach. I mean, I think Alex and I have been trying to talk to this in different ways in this chat today, but just as it's useful to overcome the notion that the classics were good for then, and we have a sort of fundamentally new reality, perhaps only because of technology now, you know, not only did those classical ideals and forms of education and character formation get reborn centuries later in a very different place, in a different cultural setting in Renaissance Europe, they have a hand, as we've mentioned briefly, in really, really recent things. So someone like Max Planck is one of the last great global achievers in physics. He had this interest in Weltanschauung, or worldview, and that meant a kind of clarity about the metaphysics behind his science, clarity about a kind of cosmology behind the science, as someone like Stanley Yaki would point out, a certain natural theology behind the mathematics. And that reverence for objective reality is a big part even of technical or mathematical or instrumental things. And I'm going off axis a little bit here, but just another example of how practical this can be even in cases of modernity, or change, or trial, or turmoil, is Winston Churchill. So, you know, if you're looking at who's the rounded, practical man of a world we still more or less recognize, it would probably be Winston Churchill. He talked about all of the technological concerns and the impacts on society that we're talking about today, even though he didn't live to see all of the technologies. But his education is basically a rhetorical education of a kind that you would have had more or less unchanged from the tradition restored by Petrarch. He had a sort of classics rhetoric education. And what's interesting about that, I think, is, again, I'm picking up your point about authenticity and persuasion. Rhetoric is a great example of a classical discipline in which the practical and the intrinsically noble come together. So someone like Cicero is talking about things that you're talking about under a different light. He's talking about logos, ethos, pathos, kairos. Who you are, your character, your ability to appeal to emotion as well as reason, your ability to seize moments, those, when you look at them from one step back, are a lot of the forces that are being shaken out in these new digital media, new marketing platforms and techniques that you're talking about. If you know, if I may say so, that's just my take.
No, I think you're absolutely right. And this is what my observation, that we're kind of re-going through that cycle, because again, some of it has been lost in terms of what, yes, as we talked about earlier, how certain elements, certain subjects and fields of study get stripped from our education system. And there's this resurgence, there's this desire, there's this need, this hunger for it.
I think Miles also touched, I mean, there's also another point that Miles, I think, touched on, which is when you're talking about Max Planck. I mean, one of the things about classical education, which is different from recent trends away from it, is it's not a specialist education in the sense that part of, I think, its purpose is for us to see the interconnection between all different forms of knowledge, right? I mean, so somebody like Max Planck, with the education that he would have received in a German gymnasium, would know at least something about philosophy, about literature, and see how all these things are interconnected. You know, a great classicist like Goethe, right, was a scientist as well, you know? So Leonardo da Vinci, right? The whole Renaissance ideal of the universal man, I think that's something that has gotten a little bit lost. And yeah, the other thing is, what he was saying about rhetoric, I thought was spot on, and it's one area where I think we're seeing something of a resurgence of interest in the classics, is in sort of this whole notion of communications, right, which has become kind of important. I find like some of those people will be going back to classical principles in terms of how do you make your pitch? How do you influence people? You know, those sorts of questions.
And what's very interesting, again, what you're bringing up too, is this sort of the multidisciplinary approach. What I'm seeing is a lot of that on a couple of fronts. One is that I'm seeing, certainly again, on LinkedIn and from a business perspective, a lot of talk about the importance, and I believe in it too, the importance of mindset, how one's attitudes and the way that we think about things have a direct impact on our outcomes. And again, referring back to the neuroscientist that I spoke to, that was one of my questions, you know, somebody had sent me these videos of a Dr. Joe Dispenza, who was taking this very multidisciplinary approach to sort of studying psychology, but also even quantum physics and spiritual lives and so on. And, you know, some very interesting sort of discussions again about, you know, the brain, the mind, what is the mind, what are its capabilities, recognizing all of a sudden these research in terms of how you know, individuals have, for example, used mindset and the way that they think about things, applying their spirituality to almost heal themselves of, it's the best explanation of how they managed to heal themselves of a certain cancer, for example. Or again, as this neuroscientist was talking about, you know, the how many neurons exist in the gut and the sort of recognition that in fact these things actually, or that the mind is actually much more complicated. And while they certainly talk about, you know, they certainly consider, neuroscientists will talk about the brain as this, or the mind as confined within the brain, that in fact, no, they now take a much more holistic, interrelated approach to how that works. And again, this, again, going back to Carl Jung and this collective mind, that we're all kind of part of these, that these things interrelate and are correlated in very kind of interesting and diverse ways.
Yeah, I mean that's really interesting. I mean, it's not really the place to probably get into it in too much depth, but the Stoics we discussed at points at the beginning when you brought in Epictetus, you know, their big thing was that the passions and the bad negative emotions that we have are also often caused by cognitive things, by the way in which we think about things, right? Things that we think are bad and that are hurting us. And if we change our way of thinking, our approach to life is going to change. And I've heard that Stoic approaches are one of the reasons that they're becoming interesting is because they match some of the developments in cognitive psychology, which I can't claim to any expertise on, but it's kind of interesting in that direction as well.
Yeah. Well, it's important for a, because that becomes now the question that people are on. From a business perspective, is, you know, what leads to success, and again, part of that is our attitudes, and what do those, and from what attitudes are the most constructive for success, and I think part of it is what people are sort of recognizing that, you know, when you externalize your cause of your failures, and you internalize all of your successes, that you know, that is almost a recipe for failure. That you need that we recognize that we are sort of the cause and effect of our own success all along the way, and that we as individuals, how we better ourselves and how we better approach challenges, because that's the thing. Is this, again, if we're going towards this sort of gig economy, well, you know, your greatest competitor is yourself. Your greatest barrier to success is yourself. And so this is again why I encourage this return, this sort of renaissance. Man, gentlemen, this is flown by. Any kind of, so from your teachings and from these classical studies, what are perhaps your words of advice or great teachings that are helpful to people's mindsets, are helpful from a business perspective in terms of growing one's individual lives and therefore perhaps being more successful in their careers?
Yeah, well, that's sort of a big question, but I think, you know, we're thinking about doing this course on Stoicism. I don't claim that this is an exhaustive answer to your question, but I think one of the things that people might find interesting about this course on Stoicism is that it was an extremely practical philosophy which is all about how to live a good life and how to confront and deal with the various things that inevitably come, whether it is people insulting you or discouraging you, whether it's the griefs and sorrows that we can't control, you know, the loss of our nearest and dearest, or illnesses, or the things that come and go. And I think that might be something that would be quite interesting to people who are looking for kind of a practical philosophy rooted in the classics. The Stoics themselves go deeper into the Socratic tradition and so forth, how to live a good life, a happy life. And I think that these kinds of perennial questions are why people will return to the classics over and over again.
Awesome. Miles, any thoughts for you?
Yeah, I would just use that as an opportunity to plug Alex's new book, actually. I believe it's coming out on Springer, the estimable label. And I think you'd look for a lovely picture, correct me if I'm wrong, of a recently unearthed bust of Aristotle on the cover. And in it, Alex tracks the kind of classical ideal from the Greek world through and into the modern age on some of the points that we talked about today. And it helps treat on things that have a lot of Lindy, as you know, Nassim Nicholas Taleb would say, you know, things that have had a very long life up till now and are likely, therefore, statistically to have about as many years in them towards the future. And the encouraging tone that you struck a couple of points during our discussion, Jules, I think is an apposite one, because on the one hand, it's we're in an age where data is almost telling us that we seem to be less free than we'd like to think. We, you know, we're maybe less the authors of our own thoughts than we'd like to be, and perhaps, you know, algorithms can predict what we're about to do next better than we do, partly just because of our own self-blindness. But the opportunity for thoroughgoing accountability, starting from the self and building in small circles through our friends and our families and other collaborations and professional that build character, is an enormous opportunity for every kind of person, whether you're a captain of industry or something like that, or someone who's just trying to pull themselves up by their bootstraps. There's a lot to lean on in this kind of rich tradition. I think we still pretty much have the Bible available to us, but also, you know, the things that have held up well, whether it's Shakespeare or whether it's some of the Greek and Latin authors we touched on briefly today, there's a lot out there that's worth your time. And I think, as we said, you know, you can find out what you ought to read by consulting the curriculum of a university, top university in the United States, even early 20th century, or even a high school in San Francisco, 19-something. You know, so it's there within reach. And because of the digital platforms we're talking about, you can actually, you know, you can actually sit in your car and listen to this stuff read to you as you go, or you can do it by podcast and by unearthed digital copies. That's the thing, you know, the Google Books phenomenon, the digital library phenomenon means you don't have to get to a large physical library to peruse, you know, great texts where the Greek is on one side and reasonably readable English is on the other side. So, you know, get out there and start digging is, I guess, the back end of my plug.
Awesome. Gentlemen, this has been a lot of fun. I'd certainly be willing to do this again. But I thank you very much, both of you, for your time. I know you're both very busy. So again, thanks so much for coming on the show.
Thanks a lot, Julian. I appreciate it. I've got to think-